Next item on the order paper is a motion on rail services between between Belfast City Centre and Belfast International Airport. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly expresses its concern at the lack of competitiveness and availability of rail services between Belfast City Centre and Belfast International Airport, and calls on the Minister for Infrastructure to investigate all options for remedial action, including the reintroduction of the Lisburn to Antrim rail link.
Thank you. I call Mr Paul Girvan to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. I take this opportunity to bring this motion to the House today on the basis that from 2003, since the closure of the Knockmore line, there has been an area of Northern Ireland that has been denied the access to the rail network. There seemed to be a policy in the past where we closed rail lines, and the Bleach Green line was one in question as well. It was reopened and is now one of the busiest routes. So if you build it, they will come. But I'm taking the line that we have villages and towns along the route here. We have Crumlin, Glenavy and Ballanderry. All of those villages and towns have grown dramatically. In fact, Crumlin has grown extensively since 1999. And in fact, it would be nearly double the size it was at that time. And as a consequence, it is an area that could and should have that rail link re-established. The Knockmore line has been in place and is currently costing us one point up to date from 2010, not from 2003, but from 2010 until now. It has cost £1.5 million to maintain in a state of potential readiness. It's also used as a training link. But our main angle within this motion today is to bring another form of transport and connectivity to our international airport. Our international airport, unfortunately, has not necessarily had the same help and assistance that Dublin has. Dublin have managed to get round what I deem to be an excuse that we have used in relation to state aid to actually encourage and suck the life out of our international airport, and in fact have done nothing but to attract routes which potentially we should become a hub for. I'm wanting to grow the traffic to the international airport. I don't see the point that they say that they need 10 million passengers coming into the international airport before they see the necessity to have a rail network. I believe that we have to put the investment into the infrastructure and ensure that we have it there. And I believe if you have that, you will attract those routes to our area. The other opportunity we have is, and something which we have not made use of, in fact it has been mentioned on the Infrastructure Committee up to now, where we have a rail network which is not being used for freight. And I believe that we could establish a freight hub as the international airport, a freight hub not just for Northern Ireland but for the whole of the United Kingdom as a major point of freight. And as a consequence of that, they have a very large land zoning round the airport which is already identified for potential growth of the airport, and I think we should be encouraging that. And to do so, I think we need, as an executive, to make a decision in relation to not just mothballing what is a real estate that we have, but actually making use of it and giving another opportunity for additional links to Lisburn, Antrim and to Belfast. And on the back of what we have already encountered up to now, which is seeing nothing but a lack of joined-up approach from both the TransLink, and I'll use TransLink as the overall head as it used to be, but rail network and the bus network not being totally joined together, and that seemed to be a point.
Will
indeed, yes.
The member talks about TransLink there, and I'm sure the member is aware that there's a bus leaves International Airport every 15 minutes to take passengers to Belfast. And do you not see the benefit then of actually a rail link, which gives an option for passengers and actually removes some more of the traffic and congestion that's actually on our roads?
I do see that as a very, very vital point, and I do think that we do need to see that complementing, not taking away from, and on the basis that we have a railway running very close to our existing airport, I think it's vitally important that we make use of the land that we have zoned already and bring a real halt into the airport itself. But as well as making mention about what it goes on from a TransLink point of view on the roads, Temple Patrick is a village which is being blighted by traffic all day, every day. And as a consequence, it is vitally important that we try to remove some of those 15-minute bus runs that are coming through what is a sleepy village. And that's, I will use that term, it is a sleepy village, but it has become a major commuting route to our international airport. And as a consequence, we need to look at other ways of dealing with that. Currently, the only quick fix to that I see is our rail link, encouraging that. Ultimately, we would like to put in the opportunity to look long-term at putting some form of link to the M2, and if that is a possibility, it's something that we should be looking at. But what we have, we all currently have infrastructure that we should be locking into for the airport itself. I do think that spending $1.5 million, really what I call putting a sticking plaster on, is basically throwing money down the drain. We'd be better investing and putting some money in. Well, indeed, yes.
Would the member agree with me that one of the significant issues we have in South Antrim is an infrastructure problem, full stop, which has been caused by a considerable amount of underinvestment over the years? And part and parcel of looking at Belfast International, which is our key international hub and one of our major economic areas, is to be able to develop a broad-ranging infrastructure strategy, particularly for South Antrim.
I have absolutely no problem with that, and I think that that's one area that we should be looking at, and not just South Antrim, but I believe that Northern Ireland as a region should be putting that forward, and I know the Minister will be focusing on that. But one of the things that we must deal with is, this was closed in 2003, In 2003, we had, under the leadership of the Ulster Unionist Party and the SDLP, they were aware of what was going on. We were pulling out of what was a potential jewel in our crown in having a rail link to our airport. And I do understand that investigations, in fact, it's not that long ago from a question was asked in this House in relation to what help could be given to Dublin to put a rail link into Dublin. And that's just basically sucking the life out of what's here. And I know that those who maybe represent border counties, such as Newry and Mourne and areas such as that, are saying, well, Dublin might be closer. But why should we not be looking at ensuring that we have the infrastructure in Northern Ireland to actually ensure that passengers are using that and making the best of it? So I think that that line is what we should be doing and making sure that our network is there. The freight aspect is something which I know the airport would welcome, because there is an opportunity. We have slots that are available. There's difficulties in flying into the likes of Belfast Harbour Airport at night. I still call it Belfast Harbour Airport, but I think I want to see the international as the main way forward. I think there's an opportunity for us to class an enterprise zone within the airport area and ensure that it could be not just for building up distribution networks, but also coming forward on the basis of business being an initiative to drive business into that area. South Antrim is an area that I have a great love for. I want to ensure I represent it. I want to make sure that we pull as much into it as possible. I want to see that networks that are there are not lost. We had a fantastic rail network in Northern Ireland back in the 1950s. It has basically been disappearing ever since. I will indeed.
Okay. Mr. Given for giving way to me in respect of this, does he also recognise that in order to achieve his ambitions for additional rail services in that part of South Antrim, that the Minister today needs to give serious consideration to the dualling of the Dargan Bridge as it crosses at York Street, and unless that is included in the York Street interchange, none of the rail improvements that are referred to will ever be able to happen because of the engineering contingencies of the York Street interchange?
I basically don't know enough about the intricacies of the full rail network, but I'm asking those who have the expertise to look at this, because I see the Knockmore line being an opportunity to create a loop, because effectively where we're talking about dualling railways along the route, it can be dealt with as given an opportunity. Met with the people from Glenavy, and just with 2 seconds, met with the people of Glenavy and with Crumlin, all of which are requesting additional services, and they believe that the railway stations which are in their villages should be opened again and being used.
Thank you. I call Jenny Palmer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. May I start by welcoming the motion? I am pleased that the party introducing it has finally decided that this rail link between Belfast City Centre and Belfast International Airport is indeed an issue worth serious concern or consideration. Indeed, in the Ulster Unionist Party's document, A Vision for Northern Ireland Outside the EU, which was launched only yesterday, my party identified 10 key asks, one of which was for a trebling of the investment in infrastructure. This obviously includes hard infrastructure such as airports, roads and railways. We have urged the Northern Ireland Executive to treble its investment in infrastructure. This will require making the case to HM Government that investing some of the funding currently being directed to Brussels should be used to increase Northern Ireland's competitiveness. There is no doubt that in an ideal world we would have a rail link to the international airport. When one looks at the situation with regard to the major airports in Great Britain, there are direct rail links to all London airports, plus Birmingham and Manchester. Newcastle Airport is connected to the city centre by the Tyneside Metro, and Edinburgh by a hugely expensive and recently completed tram system. However, Glasgow, Liverpool, Leeds, Bradford, East Midlands and Bristol airports do not have train links to their city centres, and they all rely on shuttle buses, as is the case for the international airport. With regard to the international, it is obvious that improving the transportation links to our largest airport would yield benefits to tourism and the local economy. Additionally, any modernisation and extension of the rail network in Northern Ireland has some intrinsic value as we seek to increase the use of public transport. In 2013, my colleague Danny Kennedy commissioned a consultation which estimated that the cost of reopening the Antrim-Knockmore line with a halt at the international airport would cost in the region of £50.5 million. This cost is substantial, to say the least, and would also incur ongoing maintenance costs. The key question of this motion then, Mr. Speaker, is that the benefit outweighs the cost to the taxpayer. If the new minister should use his limited funds, bearing in mind the vast deficit currently being dealt with within the department, to fund this, presumably at the expense of other projects. It would be better, in my opinion, to concentrate on the completion of the Belfast Hub project, which has the potential to transform public transport in Northern Ireland and improve and renew the Northern Ireland Railways fleet. Evidence suggests that until recently the DUP did not feel that this project was a priority use of funding. Only 5 months ago the former DRD Minister Michelle McElveen said, and I quote, "My understanding is that the usage of the airport would need to increase to around 10 million passengers to make the rail link viable." In April of this year, Managing Director of Belfast International, Mr. Graham Keddy, stated that he believed that the airport would serve 5 million people this year. This is taking into account the additional passengers travelling for major events like the Euros and the Olympic Games. It does, however, fall well short of the necessary volume to make a rail link financially viable.
the member giving way. Has she actually taken into account the difference between a railway system to serve an airport and a railway to serve the population between Antrim and Lisburn also serving the airport? Because that makes a fundamental difference to the numbers involved.
Member has extra minute.
I certainly don't concur with the opinion of my friend in terms of another 5 million passengers being found between that link. With this context in mind, I wonder, Mr. Speaker, if this motion is motivated more by the desire to be seen to be doing something than by genuine belief that this is the best use of departmental funds. This is especially true in the context of Brexit, which the party proposing the motion so vociferously supported TransLink's. TransLink's rail service has already availed of a great deal of European funding, hence the EU flag on almost every train run by the service. Given that we are set to lose out on some £58 million of TEN-T funding, I must ask, Mr. Speaker, where the proposers of this motion intend to find the money for this project?
Thank the member for giving way on that point. And I mean, I take the member back to the start of her contribution, where she talked about, and it was only launched yesterday in her own admission, their 10-point plan. And in your contribution today, you've actually said infrastructure projects were amongst that list. And indeed, you actually went on to cite that the linkage between the international airport and the city was on that list. So maybe you can tell us in your contribution now where you're getting the money in relation to your 10-point plan.
Well, now that's for you boys to have the negotiations in Europe. Mr. Deputy Speaker, given that we are set to lose out the £58 million in TEN-T funding, I must ask the Speaker, where the proposers of this motion intend to find the money for this project?
I ask the member to conclude her remarks.
It is only I didn't hear you, Mr. Speaker.
Can I ask the member to conclude your remarks? The time has now expired.
Is there not an extra minute, Mr. Speaker?
We've already allowed the extra minute, member. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, I'll finish then. It would be cynical of me, of course, to suggest that now that the
member, time is up.
No longer bears primary responsibility for acting or actually funding.
I ask the member to resume her seat. Time is now up. Thank you. Mr. Fran McCann.
Probably like many here today, I raised to speak in support of the intent of this motion, and it's called for rail services to connect Belfast city centre with Belfast International Airport. And I do believe that the destruction of rail networks many years ago was short-sighted and led to the isolation of many communities across the north, especially those in rural towns which had a rich history of rail provision. In fact, I believe we lost something when we moved from the train to the car. But I understand that there are now a number of options available to people in terms of public transport to get from A to B. The fact remains that rail can be more efficient, it is cleaner, and sends out all the right signals in terms of encouraging people out of the car or bus and onto a greener, cleaner mode of travel. When you consider that between the 4th and 13th of July this year, Belfast International Airport expected over 200,000 people to pass through its doors, which in itself was an increase of 30,000 people. Over the same period last year, most of these travelling by road to reach the airport. That figure is expected to increase over the next number of years. In fact, an international airport showed a 9% increase in 2015 with figures of 4.4 million, and that is also expected to increase. If you also consider that the huge increase in people using Belfast City Airport, it is a clear indication that more and more people are choosing to use local airports as their first choice of travel. I understand when people a number of years ago argued that the rail route would not be financially viable, but what has not been considered has been the impact of making that decision to create a rail connection between Belfast City Centre and Belfast International Airport, which could lead to a serious rise in passenger usage at the airport. It would offer that alternative form of travel to tens of thousands who use their cars today or bus. It could revitalise the small communities in its wake and send a positive message that we are committed to rail as a positive mode of transport. It could offer competition in terms of provision and could lead to a business hub in the shadow of the airport, which could create thousands of new jobs. but I do take into consideration what the last speaker said, and that is, how do we find the money at present, the resources at present, to drive that forward? Because that's a crucial element in this whole argument and this whole debate of how we create and bring in new rail networks to different parts of the north. And I think that's something I think that parties in here probably need to get their heads around and discuss the impact of going to the train rather than the car and the bus. But I certainly leave that in the hand of people in the executive to work out the best way to think. Pardon? Yes, sir.
I thank the member for giving way, and I think it's right and proper to suggest about where the funding's coming. But I mean, if you look at the motion the way we've worded it, and I think you have picked up on the essence of that, unlike the previous speaker, we're actually asking the minister and his department to investigate options. But in those options, and one of the things that even hasn't been talked about, is the Ballymartin Park and Ride. It's another facility where we're actually bringing people out of Belfast. It's removing some of the tensions that's in Belfast, and indeed actually increases investment, because it means people who are actually on business can move and make their journeys easier. So if you actually look at the motion, we're not actually suggesting the Minister must do it. We're actually asking them to investigate ways that it can be actually done.
Members, an extra minute.
Sure, and I don't disagree with what's been said. I think it's like everything we debate down here and discuss in many ways is a wish list somewhere down the lane. I do believe that in the Minister for Infrastructure today, of a person who's not only willing to listen, but also to look at how best you plan and put into operation things that could benefit our communities in the longer term down the road. Thank you.
Call Mr. Daniel McCrossan.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I am grateful for the opportunity to speak in support of today's motion, and I thank the proposers of this motion for bringing the important issue to this House. The SDLP support improved connectivity between all of our airports and rail services, and access to airports through direct railways is a hallmark of most major European and international cities, and is essential to expanding Northern Ireland as a business and tourist destination. Airport rail links are vital to any European city and any country that must compete for inward investment. Mr. Deputy Speaker, over the summer holidays, like many in this House, I've been abroad. I've been to London, Barcelona, and it amazes me how connected public transport is and how efficient the services are. I think that this should be our ambition here in Northern Ireland, and that we should seize the opportunity and reap the many benefits airport rail connectivity can bring. Mr. Deputy Speaker, as we consider the programme for government and infrastructural needs, it is my view that a modern Northern Ireland must have modern rail infrastructure, and we must ensure the continued development of a modern railway system throughout the north and across this island. To address today's motion, in 2016, the fact that we do not have a rail link to Belfast International Airport or any other airport is nothing short of scandalous, Minister. Any airport rail link to and from Belfast International Airport has the potential to stimulate economic growth, not only in Belfast, but throughout the entirety of Northern Ireland. It also has the potential to assist with the growth of tourism through the provision of direct access for air passengers, and it would also offer a long-term sustainable public transport alternative for accessing the international airport. It would reduce congestion and would provide important environmental benefits, as articulated by other members. Over the past number of years, there has been a number of proposals put forward in terms of establishing a direct line to Belfast International Airport, which includes reopening the Knockmore line through the construction of a rail spur to provide a halt serving the international airport. Mr. Deputy Speaker, if operational, the Knockmore line will enable the international airport to be accessed directly from stations across Northern Ireland by connecting with existing services from Lisburn to Belfast or Portadown and from Antrim to Belfast. It will also allow for far greater west to east train connectivity, because the Knockmore line will link the international airport with Derry, while there is also the potential to link Derry with Dublin for a train journey that would last 3.5 hours. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we consider the infrastructural deficits in the West, and I've spoken clearly about them since I've been elected to this House. The failure to develop the A5 and A6, expanding the limited rail infrastructure, could go some way to alleviating the regional imbalance my constituents and the people of the West have suffered for decades. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we must also consider the costings, and it has been estimated that the reopening of the Knockmore line may cost something in the region of £100 million. I asked the Minister how much it has cost to maintain the line in the 13 years since it was originally closed. We know since 2012 it has cost $1.5 million despite only being used as an emergency. I would ask the Minister, rather than pay for a railway line that serves little purpose, to invest in and pay for a railway line that serves the North and its people. The Minister has also said that in order for the service to become economically sustainable, there needs to be 10 million passengers per year, which is 5.5 million short, however. We look at the population projections. The airport will reach 10 million by 2035. I ask the Minister, would it be better to invest now rather than pushing this issue down the track for another day? Mr. Deputy Speaker, although today's debate focuses solely on the Belfast International Airport, we must also consider rail connectivity to our two other regional airports, Belfast City and the City of Derry. When you look at the former, the Sydenham Halt is about 0.5 mile down the road from the airport, and you often see passengers with suitcases walking along the roads, very dangerous circumstances, and it is not acceptable. It is my view, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that the Halt could be moved adjacent to the City Airport with an overroad accommodation bridge for foot passengers. I would welcome the Minister's views on this and whether a feasibility study has been conducted. Mr. Deputy Speaker, to conclude, I support today's motion. The rail infrastructure of the North is not fit for purpose, and if we genuinely want to compete internationally for investment and want to boost local tourism, airport rail connectivity plays a central role and is up to the Minister to lead on this. And I do believe, Minister, that you could lead fully on this and set the bar very high. Thank you, Mr. Deputy.
Thank you. I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. On behalf of the Alliance Party, I rise to support this motion. The motion highlights a key question for the Minister. How attractive is he making Northern Ireland to business travellers and for tourism? If we are to attract inward investment and to grow our tourism market, then we need better connectivity and investment in public transport solutions. By making it easier for people to get about, we make Northern Ireland easier to visit and therefore easier to do business with. I welcome the call for the Minister to investigate options that would enable the reopening of the Lisburn to Antrim line and provide accessibility to Belfast International Airport for the following reasons. Firstly, local people want this line reopened. The local community in Crumlin, Glenavy, Ballanderry and the surrounding areas support the reopening of the Lisburn to Antrim line. The local community has petitioned my colleague David Ford, who has consistently brought this issue forward to successive ministers, only to be told that it will be considered in the future as part of a long-term plan. On the long finger. The line was closed in 2003. That's 13 years ago. This is a very long finger. The local community is very frustrated by the lack of progress on this issue. During recent Antrim and Newton Abbey Borough Council community planning consultation sessions, the community reiterated its wish for the line to be reopened and for the Council to initiate a project under the Connecting Our Communities theme, potentially in partnership with the Department. This opportunity will not progress if the Minister and the Department continue to consider the issue on the long finger. The Minister should look to his regional development strategy, where increasing modal shift from car to public transport figures strongly. In this instance, we have a community who would use the public transport system but are unable to do so because the line is closed to the public. The line is maintained and operational for training and emergency rail use at a considerable cost, as has already been mentioned, but it's not available for use for passengers. Really? £1.5 million not available to passengers? Secondly, the Minister and his department has predetermined the cost benefit of reopening the line is too expensive based on a TransLink estimate of £100 million, not on actual cost. In July of this year, in response to a written question from David Ford, the Minister confirmed the reopening of Antrim to Bleach Green line was £18.2 million. While I accept the Lisburn to Antrim line may be more expensive, it does raise the question, is the £100 million a fact-based figure or a guesstimate? I will.
It might be of interest to note, particularly on the sort of the Mossley line, when the original projections were made of cost, it was not expected there would be any growth in traffic, and indeed there was a lot of criticism at the time of the investment in there. I understand the Minister has some choices to make, but one of the most interesting things is this idea of building it and they will come. There is no doubt there is a large amount of interest in improving sort of rail links through this area. And I would encourage the Minister in particular, to get the Department to look critically at future growth rather than present growth projections, particularly across the great constituency of South Antrim. But thank you very much indeed.
Members, an extra minute.
Thank you. It is therefore appropriate that the Minister considers reopening the line based on figures, as have been mentioned, but not that are on factual basis. Can I continue on? We've run out of time. Thank you. An investigation would give TransLink the opportunity to provide a detailed business case showing the actual cost to maintain and modernise the line with a view to reopening for passenger use. It is not appropriate for the Minister or Department to continue to ignore the opportunity on the basis of an estimate. Thirdly,
can I give way briefly?
Yes, certainly, briefly.
I'm sure since my colleague was not a member of the House at the time, she was unaware that some years ago before the property crash, that there was a private business was interested in investing in the line, given development opportunities on it, which could well have provided a cost-effective service and would undoubtedly have been significantly cheaper than the £100 million guesstimate which is being prepared, particularly in the light of what Mr. Aiken has just highlighted about the potential for growth.
Thank you. As I've been talking about figures, the other reason, the third reason that's been given is repeatedly the passenger numbers through the international airport needs to be around 10 million. I'm unclear as to what that figure actually is based upon. Is it the TransLink calculation where a number of passenger trips is counted, or is it actually the through flow in the airport? If we're to understand if the project is to be economically viable, then we need figures quoted as targets to be clarified. If we assume that the 10 million is the number of passengers, the ability for the airport to grow to reach the proposed figure is being stymied by the lack of joined up or integrated transport solutions for on travel for business and other passengers. This lack of joined up regional transport planning and provision has been highlighted by airlines over a number of years, but amazingly no survey of the business or tourism community appears to have been completed to establish a better connectivity to Aldergrove would benefit or improve business. In the Regional Development Strategy, it highlighted the need to promote regional gateways as economic development opportunities, to exploit the economic development of the key transport corridors, to undertake or, where appropriate, facilitate a programme of infrastructure improvement essential to business needs, and to promote a sustainable approach to the provision of tourism. If the Minister is to deliver the Regional Development Strategy to 2025, then he must take action to consider the viability of opening a line and enabling better connectivity, as has been mentioned, it needs to take into consideration the York Gate interchange, and creating that better connectivity to our international airport. While I appreciate the loss of potential income streams following Brexit, I reiterate we need to make Northern Ireland attractive to business and tourist travellers by making it easy to travel once they arrive here. And finally, if Northern Ireland is to reduce carbon emissions and congestion, the Minister and the Department of Infrastructure must create the ability for modal shift and prioritise investment in public transport. When I was in business, I travelled to England often, and it was easy to go to have a meeting in a place where there was onward travel availability. My counterparts do not come to Northern Ireland because it's too difficult to travel across the country here.
I ask the member to conclude her remarks.
Thank you. Road building has been prioritised over public transport. If we want to entice businesses, tourists and to meet the needs of our local communities, then
Members,
there needs to be
up.
A shift in departmental investment. Thank you.
I call Mr. Edwin Putz.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Good to see you in the chair. And this is something which goes back with myself and with Mr. Ford a very long way. I remember standing in Crumlin with Oliver Frawley fighting the campaign to keep the Knockmore to Antrim railway line open at that time. And as I look at mothballed railway lines, in particular one that runs through my constituency between Lisburn and Banbridge, and I think of the time that would be taken off that Belfast to Dublin rail route if it had kept that line open, and obviously the avoidance of Lurgan and the problems that arise every so often whenever some brave Irish heroes think that it's going to achieve United Ireland by blocking the railway line between Belfast and Dublin. I can only look at with regret at the mothballing of that railway line, which is probably beyond bringing back. But whenever I look at the Knockmore-Sprucefield railway line, it is not beyond bringing back. There is every opportunity to restore that railway line with imagination, with conviction, with good business sense. And that is why we have put forward this motion, because it's not something that we believe will be delivered very, very quickly, but nonetheless it is something that we believe that can be achieved, and it is something that we need to be focused on and targeting. I should say that Mrs. Armstrong's last comment about England being so much easier to travel around than Northern Ireland is patent nonsense, and most people who come from England remark how much easier it is to travel around Northern Ireland than it is to travel around England, where the rail networks are heavily congested. Yes, I will give away, but where rail networks are heavily congested and heavily overpriced.
Thank you for giving way. Just on that point, in England you can get on a train, travel anywhere, no difficulty, there's halts necessary, there's accessibility. We are completely and utterly disconnected, and I think that the minister that needs to be appreciated in this debate.
Members, an extra minute.
Thank you for that, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Travelling around England is a nightmare, actually, if I could respond to the point, Mr. Regan, travelling around England is a nightmare compared to what we have in Northern Ireland. And whilst our public transport network is not as good as it should be, and considerable work has to be done on that, nonetheless, Northern Ireland is a very, very accessible place, with little over an hour from one side of it to the other. I look forward to hearing from Mr. Regan, because the last time I heard from him, he seemed to contradict his colleague, who had spoken earlier on, and I'm completely confused as to what the Ulster Union's position is. Are they supporting this motion? Are they against this motion? Do they want to see the railway re-established? Does Mr. Aiken want this service running through his constituency? Because it appeared that Mrs. Palmer didn't, so perhaps he can clarify this. We'll let Mr. Aiken go.
See, I was rising and asked for the member to give way to actually support the member's statement about sort of English railways. And as somebody who's been stuck in the Great Western Railway, laughingly called the rapid transit route across the central section of England, I can fully appreciate those issues. And actually, it's quite unusual for somebody to come to stand and support that, your comment, but that is indeed true. And we'll address those other issues as we go further in the discussion. But thank you.
Very useful contribution, Mr. Aiken. Mr. Free.
I thank the member for giving way, and I also appreciate the work that this member, that you have put into this campaign over the last number of years around your constituency. How does it make you feel when you see a large party within this place, the Ulster Unionist Party, completely divided on this very issue, very much like they were divided in Europe, whereby some of their members were campaigning for leave and other members were campaigning to stay? How does that make you feel?
Well, it doesn't really matter that much to me.
Could I say, I think we're going off the rails.
I think that's very common, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and we'll maybe try and get back on track again. Mr. Hazard has a very substantial job in terms of infrastructure in Northern Ireland. Considerable downs have been made, I think, over the course of the last 10 to 15 years. And we look at the road network, we look at the train sets that have been bought and the quality of those train sets, and we look at lines like the Bangor right through the Port of Down line, which is so well used. We want to extend that, we want to encourage that. We see that even in the new line to Londonderry, I think that the numbers using it now are 225% greater than what was anticipated. So let us actually reinvigorate our railways. Let us see how we can invest in our railway systems to ensure that we do better. And I think connecting the people in Lisburn and Antrim, who may well be in one constituency in due course, would be a great thing to do. And we can do that together. And the 10 million that is required for the airport is augmented by the numbers who are using it. You do not have 10 million passengers using the railway line. You need 10 million passengers going through the airport to get the appropriate number using the railway line.
I ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. I call Mr. Declan Kearney.
I ask you, Cornelia, as current file chair of an Jasperock Chart, has she in Doc Santa Sacker Fad, as Tasha Fearyakanak, go well Argent Tunnel, Egerius Jack, and Kesht Huntasak Shaw. I speak in support of this motion. The reality is that there is a lack of competitiveness and availability of rail services between Belfast and the International Airport. In my constituency of South Antrim, there is indeed, and it has been touched on by other speakers, a very long-held local desire for the Lisburn to Antrim rail line to be restored, and I support that wish. There's been a dramatic increase in the population growth within the wider Crumlin, Glenavy, Balland area area over the last 30 years. There's been quite a phenomenal explosion in population. Once small rural villages are now growing towns, with large numbers commuting daily, particularly for work and for education into Belfast. This is a catchment which is badly served by public transport generally. Bus services in that particular part of the Lough Shore area are completely inadequate. So the transport infrastructure in these parts of South Antrim does not correspond to the needs of local people. And I welcome the fact that myself and local constituents will be meeting with the Minister in October, I hope, to deal with some of the issues which are now unfolding as a result of these very serious difficulties within the local transport infrastructure. However, the reality is that the design of local infrastructure, transport infrastructure, fails the needs of local business, and in turn that fails to assist in optimising economic growth or attracting new investment opportunities, both locally and from abroad. Not surprisingly, in parallel with the growth in population, there's been a spike in car use, with inevitable environmental consequences in terms of the carbon footprint and so on. The Antrim to Knockmore section of the Lisburn Railway line runs directly past Belfast International Airport, yet, as other speakers have correctly observed, there is no connection. The role of the airport complex as an economic driver for growth and investment in our regional economy cannot be ignored in the context of this debate. In the last 2 years, there has been a significant upswing in passenger footfall and air routes available through Aldergrove Airport. The airport has also benefited from important commercial investment. It has the potential, in my view, to become an enterprise zone in the future, and it should be recognised and nurtured as a strategic economic hub within the regional economy. However, that growth trajectory, that potential, is in fact fettered and limited by the absence of an overall integrated transport infrastructure. Now, I understand the business case which argues that passenger numbers in the airport do not meet the criteria for direct rail connection from Belfast. But equally, I don't accept, and I do believe, that we should not wait until all the conditions are met before acting. Yes.
I thank the member for giving way on that point about the passenger numbers, and I think that's the point that we wanted to draw out when I wanted the intervention against Kelly Armstrong. The difficulty I have with the projections from the department are, in terms of, we went to the projections for the coal into Londonderry line, whenever it was actually built, it was 225% more than was actually estimated. So they actually can't accurately estimate how many people are going to use the line. And as you have rightly said, the figures in those areas are the numbers of the population are growing, so it only by default will suggest that the number of passengers is going to grow.
Well, I thank the member for that contribution, and I will revisit
member
that,
an extra minute.
That point in due course. But we cannot approach this issue in zero-sum terms. If the proper standard of transport infrastructure, including rail provision, is put in place, economic growth, new investment and population expansion will inevitably follow. All the options, including light rail rapid transport investment, should be considered fully. So we do need to come at this in terms of what we can do and what we ought to do, as opposed to what we cannot do simply on the basis of what we are told. I understand that the Minister must contend with unremitting pressure upon his departmental budget, the impacts of worsening austerity due to British Tory policy, and also the unforeseen economic and investment damage which is going to be caused as a result of the Brexit decision. There is an even greater need, in the face of that type of adversity, for blue sky thinking, and I refer that point directly back to my colleague's earlier intervention. We need to coordinate the transport policy, foreign direct investment, industrial policy in the six counties, job creation and environmental priorities. We should be innovative and ambitious, even with the limited resources available. In that sense, we need to be thinking about investing to accumulate, and investing to accumulate arising from our neglected transport infrastructure. So all of our executive departments and officials need to think about strategic challenges differently. Thinking the same way and doing things the same way will only guarantee more of the same results. investing in rail services between Belfast and the regional airport, and also on the Lisburn to Antrim rail link, should be seen as a strategic opportunity to finish, Mr. Speaker, to help transform the regional economy and to modernise our local transport infrastructure, and particularly in my constituency of Southampton.
I call Mr. Alex Easton.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion and say from the outset that I think this motion is a no-brainer. At a time when we want to improve lives, enhance trade, create jobs, attract foreign investment and compete on a level playing field with our neighbours, then we need to ensure that we have the best possible infrastructure to support those aims. It is therefore vitally important that for us to compete in a global economy, that our international airport has the best possible infrastructure in place to attract all those aims. The lack of a fast, efficient rail network from Belfast to the international airport, in my opinion, is both criminal, short-sighted and is hampering growth plus foreign investment into our local economies. We know one of the main factors in attracting business and indeed even foreign airline companies coming to Northern Ireland is to have the right infrastructure in place for quick and easy access from the airport for passengers and businesses. In order to get to the main investment hubs, and the way to do that is to have a quick and fast transport system. In a world that moves in a quick pace, we in Northern Ireland are lacking the facilities that are lagging behind our competitors. We know our main competitors are seriously looking at the possibility of extending their own infrastructure, for example, with both the second runway at Dublin Airport and also a rail network straight into Dublin from Dublin International Airport is under serious consideration. If we are serious about attracting foreign investment, jobs, and failed... Yep.
Would the member agree with me that the activity of the Irish government and the Dublin Airport authorities is both anti-competitive and is definitely detrimental to the Northern Ireland economy, and particularly the state funding for Terminal 2, the state funding for the outstanding debt for Dublin Airport authorities, pension funds, and also the state funding for the second runway is again anti-competitive examples that we in Northern Ireland need to fight against.
Members, an extra minute.
Yes, I thank the member for his intervention and I don't disagree with you, so thank you for that. Okay, jobs. Yes.
I thank the member for giving way. There's been a lot of discussion lately about how difficult it can be for us to compete against Dublin Airport at times, and some of those things are outside of our control. Things that Dublin Airport are able to offer, for example, pre-clearance to the United States. Doesn't an airport, a railway link at the airport, go some way into making us a more attractive opportunity for travellers?
Thank the member for his intervention and would agree with that. If we fail to act on this motion, then our competitors will have the economic edge. We are aware that the previous Department for Regional Development did undertake a public consultation during 2013 called the Railway Investment Prioritisation Strategy. This was about how we could take forward and prioritise future investment in the Northern Ireland rail network up to 2035. One of those priorities was identifying in priority three, which is what we're sort of talking about today. One of the main arguments that will be used for the case not to reopen the Antrim to Knockmore-Lisburn line will be that such an investment would not be viable as airport passenger numbers, which in 2013 stood at around 4 million. And for the project to be viable, this needs to grow to about 10 million. However, I would argue that the airport numbers are projected to grow to the 10 million mark by 2030. And we can see from current levels that there has been an 8.9% increase in the last year, as well as a 2.5% increase in aircraft movements. So we can see there's a positive movement in increased flight numbers and passenger numbers. And I would argue that if we had the right railway connection to Belfast in place, and to the airport, this would attract passengers and foreign investment and compete with our neighbours and increase those numbers even more quicker. Looking at the potential cost to reopen the Antrim to Knockmore line and a link to Belfast would cost in around the 50 million mark, and this would involve the rehabilitation and resignalling of the track between Antrim and Knockmore, construction of a single track spur and rail halt at the airport, two additional trains, stations renewals at Ballinderry, Crumlin and Glenavy Park, and a park and ride. I believe that failure to do this would be folly, For example, in 2014, Dr. Peter Boland, Director of International Tourism Management Studies at the University of Ulster, stated that the lack of a rail link to Belfast International was detrimental to Northern Ireland, as was one of the reasons why there had been a failure to secure a long-haul route to Canada. And that this... very quickly, yeah.
Points the member is making. I'm just slightly concerned that he doesn't seem to recognise that there were services on the Knockmore line until they were closed by a former Minister for Regional Development by the name of Gregory Campbell, who he appears to have described as a criminal and his work as folly.
Thank the member for his useless information. Dr. Boland further said that if Northern Ireland was serious ambitions to develop its economy by bringing in investment from countries such as China or North America, it must improve its transport infrastructure, particularly with regard to the main airport. International visitors simply just expect that, but instead they're limited to buses and taxis, which isn't always ideal. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, as we enter talks on Brexit, we will be entering into a whole new set of negotiations for new and exciting global deals, which we in Northern Ireland want to benefit from. If we want to benefit, then it makes sense to invest in a rail link from Belfast to our main airport and show to the world we are open for business, investment and job opportunities. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. I call Mr. Steve Aiken.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, we welcome the motion on providing improved access between Belfast City and Belfast International. Indeed, on our recently launched A Vision for Northern Ireland Outside the EU, we specifically called for improving infrastructure. And I'm sure the Minister of Infrastructure and other executive ministers are already aware of the discussions ongoing in London on the provision of a significant potential infrastructure stimulus. A stimulus that could be transformational if used to significantly enhance our position as a gateway to the EU. End of plug. It would also be useful to note that Belfast International Airport will come close and might possibly exceed 5.2 million passengers. 2017 is expected to be a better year, maybe pushing towards 7 million. Looking at the indicators within the airport, retail and food beverage outlets are reporting high double-digit increases in business. And one of the things I'm most pleased to report that this increased activity has generated over 800 jobs this year, with 100 additional posts to be created shortly. I think that is a great success story. Indeed, the 1,000-acre site is a major economic hub for Northern Ireland, second only to the Belfast Harbour Estate for employment numbers, and airlines such as EasyJet and Ryanair have now made Gatwick the most important airport for Northern Ireland passengers, eclipsing Heathrow, with extra capacity being added on this route all the time. With Ryanair launching 4 new routes, including Berlin and Milan, and with 6 extra routes coming, I think all of this House will be pleased to note that the airport has had a very good season, and it's looking to have a better year next year. And I think all in the Assembly should thank Graeme Keddy and his team for all that he has done, not only for South Antrim, but for all of Northern Ireland. But our major international gateway, and this is where I agree with members of the DUP, our major international gateway has been hampered by unfair competition. And I welcome the opportunity to compare the access that has been afforded to the fully state-aided and state-supported edifice that is Dublin Airport. To observe and listen to the advertisements, again state-funded, about the so-called great access that Dublin Airport has, coupled with significant enhancements, including the potential provision of a new runway, again state-funded. It is concerned that Tourism Ireland, of which Northern Ireland contributes over a third of its budget, actively promotes Dublin Airport as the gateway to Ireland, and this raises obviously concerns about competition. Couple this with the abolition of Irish APD, VAT at 9%, there are roads that have been EU-funded, well-established transport links to two terminals, and you can see that the improvements that Belfast International has made is just about well-nigh very remarkable, and they should be supported for it. But the competition will get even further skewed as our major airports are being starved of access. And again, as has been pointed out, can we name any major airport on these islands that does not have at least dual carriageway access? Indeed, Mr. Speaker, may I take the indulgence of quoting one of my constituents who have contacted me on this issue. Our roads access is deplorable. What other major international airport do you go to and get stuck behind a tractor, or even worse? Our roads owe more to the 1950s than the 21st century. We need at least carriageway access from the M2 with a potential Temple Patrick bypass, and improvements to the other main access route, the A56. There is also no advanced planning underway to build infrastructure to meet increased passenger demand. Everything is left on the long finger. As for rail, we were told years ago that a rail spur would be viable if we hit 8 million. Yet as numbers grow, there is no discussion on this matter, Minister. So what are the ex-executive going to do about this, apart from utilising Dublin Airport regularly? And I, no doubt, and all of the many thousand-plus workers who keep our workers here and the aircraft based here flying, would be very interesting in seeing which ministers and officials use Dublin rather than our own airports. We as a party in supporting the motion call for a much wider discussion on improving access. We welcome an improved rail system across all of South Antrim, and connecting the airport should also include facilitating a major park and ride facility at Crumlin, and indeed a rail station at Ballymartin Park and Ride should progress with a degree of urgency. But we would, as a matter of priority, push for the dual carriageway link from the M2 to be built first, and any additional infrastructure made available in the autumn statement should be fast-tracked to this provision. Indeed, the Executive could significantly push the success of this programme by fast-tracking, along with Antrim and Newtownabbey Borough Council, planning for such a link and doing it now. But more importantly, APD has to go. And indeed, we note the Scottish Government is already planning to reduce Scottish APD.
Remarks.
Thank you. And finally, while not germane to this discussion, we must address the challenge of Dublin Airport. We are all for competition, but competition against the state-aided airport seeking all-island monopoly must be challenged. Thank you for your indulgence, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
I call Mr. Gordon Lyons.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And it's a privilege and a pleasure to follow the member for South Antrim, who's been very positive about the motion that is in front of us today, unlike his colleague from Lagan Valley, who I'm not still sure if she supports the motion or not, but perhaps Mr. Aiken could have a little word into her ear and get the support. I'd rather not, but I will. I don't want to hear any negativity now from the member, but if she's upbeat and positive, then I will.
Well, my opening remarks, I have to remind the Assembly, were, may I start by welcoming the motion? Indeed, we are fully supportive of the motion, but we have issues.
I wish she would have continued in the vein in which she started, but we're pleased that she's now saying she's going to support the motion that's in front of the House today, and I welcome that. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I welcome this motion because I think it's important that we do have a rail link to Belfast International Airport, to the city of Belfast. And I'm pleased that this motion is asking for the Minister to explore options today. I think that's important that we actually find out what is needed and what is necessary for this to happen, because we have a lot of figures bandied about today about how much this may cost, how many airport passengers we're going to need, how many rail passengers we might need, how much it will cost to sustain the line. We've heard about the costs of currently maintaining the line in its current unused state. So I think we do need to explore this. We need to find out, nail these figures down, because I understand that some of these figures are from quite a few years ago. So it is important that we take the time and have this feasibility study that was originally proposed in the previous document, the strategy that was produced by the Department for Regional Development a few years ago. If we have those facts, it will put us in a better position in order. I'll give way very briefly.
If we could give way, and if I could ask the Minister, instead of looking at this purely at potential growth figures of people using Belfast International Airport, but taking the views of all the South Antrim MLAs here, talking about the overall growth of the population of the area and looking at that as part of a wider prospect as well. And I'm sure that the party, the DUP, would be delighted to look at those wider options as well to improve those links.
I think that the certainly people in South Antrim and people across Northern Ireland
welcome
this. Member
has an extra minute if he chooses to use it.
Thank.
And can I ask him, remind him to address all remarks through the chair?
I will, of course, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I agree with what the member has said in relation to that. I think it is important to note that this figure as well has been used of the 10 million passengers that would be needed through the airport. There's lots of other rail stations linked to airports across the country that don't have those sorts of figures. Prestwick Airport in Glasgow is 600,000. Southampton is 1.7 million. Belfast Airport is 4 million. That doesn't include, obviously, the other passengers that will use that line, travelling perhaps between Lisburn Antrim or wherever else. Mr Speaker, I used to be a frequent user of Newcastle International Airport, and they have the metro link, the Tyne and Wear metro from Newcastle and Sunderland right into Newcastle Airport. And I have seen the economic growth and development that came along that line as a result of it being there. So I think other members have mentioned it already. We don't only look at the possible passengers that are going to use it, but the other growth that can come along that line, not just the airport alone. So we want to see better connectivity, and I think we also need to look at the truth that will come from all of this, which is that more people may actually use the airport because there will be a train line there. People like the certainty of knowing there will be a train coming along. Buses, sometimes people are not sure where to get them, not sure where they will go, but trains, railways, one of the easiest ways to travel. You only have to look at the transport statistics from Northern Ireland over the last 15 or 16 years. In the first decade of this century, we had a 60% increase in the number of people using the railways. And even in the last 3 or 4 years, we've had a 30% increase. Now, one of the reasons why that happened was because there was an increase in investment in the railway lines in Northern Ireland. And so I think it's the same again here. If the investment is put in, like Mr. Aiken said, I think if you build it, people will use it. So I understand that the Minister, Mr. Hazard, has an awful lot on his plate. There are competing groups, there are competing interests, there are competing priorities that are on his desk. But I think it is important that, at least on such an important issue that has the potential to grow the accessibility of the international airport and therefore grow our tourism potential, that we at least explore the option of a rail link at the international airport. And of course, the important thing to remember and to realise is that the line is already there. We're not proposing a completely new construction here. It's there, it's not being used, and all we're asking today is for the Minister to look into the feasibility of doing something with that. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Mr. Jerry Mullen. I have to advise Mr. Mullen that because of the tight timescales involved in this debate and the timescales agreed by the Business Committee, I can only allocate him 4 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Mr. Deputy Speaker, as a member for East Derry constituency, I too welcome the opportunity to speak in support of today's debate, and I thank the proposer of the motion for bringing it to the Chamber here today. Rail connectivity is a major issue in my constituency, and there have been some major advances in upgrading services, carriages and hulls in recent times. Indeed, I was fortunate enough to be invited to attend the opening of the new Bellarina halt in June, which has provided a great boost for local rail passengers. Mr. Speaker, Deputy Speaker, in relation to today's motion, as outlined by my colleague from West Tyrone, the SDLP are in support of improving our rail infrastructure, and a vital component of that is an improving airport rail connectivity. Access to airports through direct rail linkages forms a vital part of any modern city and region, especially when we consider its importance in attracting foreign direct investment and in terms of boosting local tourism. In this regard, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we have seen cities throughout Europe invest heavily in their airport rail connectivity, and we've all experienced this when we travel to the continent and even on these islands. For example, no sooner do you land at London Heathrow than you're navigating your way through the London Underground. This is a hallmark of any modern city which prioritises connectivity that saves travellers both time and stress, and it is something that we in the north of this island should prioritise. Mr. Deputy Speaker, today's debate has been informative in terms of highlighting the many issues that surround establishing a rail link to the international airport, especially through the reopening of the Knockmore line, and I'm sure that in spite of the political posturing that we've seen across the chamber today, that I think we can agree the majority of members are in support of this, especially those in the Antrim constituencies. Despite no feasibility study being conducted, it is estimated that the reopening of the Knockmore line will cost upwards of £100 million. But as my predecessor John Dollett has highlighted in the last mandate, the Department of Regional Development had been spending vast sums on the maintenance of the 20-mile stretch of line from Antrim to Lisburn with little or no return. I would therefore ask the current minister to detail how much his department has spent to date on the line since it closed 13 years ago and where exactly this money has been spent. Surely, Mr. Speaker, Deputy Speaker, this money would be better to put to better use if it was invested in a project that would see the reopening of the Knockmore line permanently, which would be a massive boost not only for travellers from Belfast city centre, but for travellers from across the north. This is especially the case when we consider the prospect of having a rail link from Derry to Dublin, a service that would allow people from my constituency of East Derry and from Foyle to be able to travel by rail rather than relying on buses that are inconvenient and inaccessible for many people. Mr. Deputy Speaker, although today's motion focuses solely on the international airport, the people of my constituency want to see greater rail connectivity to and from the city of Derry Airport in Eglinton, where the Derry to Belfast service runs adjacent to the airport, yet no halt exists for airport passengers. The construction of a railway halt at Derry Airport has the potential to transform connectivity in the North West, especially when we are attempting to attract record numbers of tourists into the area. It would not only serve the people of Derry City, but it could also act as a gateway by connecting Castle Rock, Downhill, Coleraine and Port Stewart. And, Mr Deputy Speaker, there is also a possibility of constructing a railway halt at the Shackleton site in Ballykelly as well. I therefore ask the Minister, what consideration has he given to the possibility of constructing a rail halt at the City of Derry Airport and whether he plans for his department to conduct a feasibility study?
The member for giving way. Does the member recognise that the argument that he makes is somewhat weak?
The member's time is up. I'm afraid we have to conclude. Oh. Thank you. Order. The business committee has agreed to meet at 1 p.m. Today, and I propose, therefore, by leave of the assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. First item of business when we return will be question time. This debate will continue after question time when the Minister will respond to the debate. Thank you.
Members, we now return to the debate on rail services between Belfast City Centre and Belfast International Airport. I call the Minister for Infrastructure to respond to the debate, and Minister Hazard will have 15 minutes.
Thank the members from the benches opposite for bringing this motion here to the Assembly today. As part of a small island off the mainland of Europe, we are entirely reliant on our airports and indeed our ports to access key markets and destinations, whether that's for pleasure, business, education or simply to visit family and friends. We are fairly unique in that regard, and that's reflected in the fact that we have significantly more air passengers relative to our population than anywhere else on these islands.
Deputy Principal Speaker, so Minister, I think we all in this Assembly will note with concern Ryanair's announcement today of the cutting of the Stansted route from Derry London Derry City of Airport, the removal of the route to Faro, and also the already reduced route to that is going to Liverpool. I would like a message through to the Assembly is that I'm sure the Minister would like to look closely now, particularly at access to our airports, and maybe through the rest of the Northern Ireland Executive, push for issues to do with APD, access to airports, road and rail link as well.
I thank the member for his intervention. While it's not entirely relating to this particular subject, let the member be under no misunderstanding. And I suppose this goes back to this motion indeed. These are not issues that the Executive just simply don't look at. They're looked at regularly or constantly under review. It's not a case that we simply now need to turn that this is news out of the blue, that this is we need to do this. Putting our airports and our ports and connectivity forefront of the agenda is something that I do day and daily and the Executive has on its radar. So certainly, rest assured, there will be plenty of commentary about that specific issue over the next number of days, and no doubt I hope you are reassured. I suppose, to get back to today's motion, and while it's not the subject of today's motion, it is important that we acknowledge that the connections which our airports and ports provide will be increasingly important in creating the conditions for prosperity and key to our ability to compete in a global, skills-based and innovative economy, not simply for markets, but also for investment and talent. Of course, it is not just the overseas connections from our airports and ports which are important. The connections to our airports and ports within the North are critically important. And for me, this is the core issue of today's motion. because in proposing this motion, my colleagues are not seeking a rail link for its own sake. It is about realising their and my ambitions for improving access to our key gateways for all parts of the North. Over recent years, this Assembly has supported the Executive in delivering a significant programme of investment which has aimed to enhance regional access, including to Belfast International Airport. This has included dual carriageway provision on the A4 west in Dungannon and the A1 around the south of Newry, as well as the widening of the M1 West Link and M2. By enhancing access to Belfast International Airport, these have helped reduce the time and cost of travel for businesses and communities across the north. I and my executive colleagues are determined to continue to build on this. The executive's commitment to deliver the $258 million upgrade of the A6 will address the historic underinvestment in this corridor and significantly enhance access to the international airport from the northwest. Alongside the delivery of the A5, I see this as a key to unlocking the economic potential of the West and delivering on our ambitions for more balanced regional growth. Investing in our road infrastructure on its own won't, however, do that all on its own. It needs to be part of a more integrated package across government, and it also needs to be accompanied by measures which enhance access to and promote greater use of public transport, including for those accessing the airport. The need to enhance connectivity, with a particular focus on increasing the numbers using public transport, is a key outcome within the Executive's draft programme for government, and we have been very careful in how we have defined that, because ultimately it's not about building roads or investing in rail and buses, it is about connecting people and opportunities. Achieving modal shift from the car to our bus or rail services for longer journeys and to walking or cycling for shorter journeys will reduce demands on the road network, allowing it to work more efficiently, assist in the better movement of freight, reduce emissions and improve health by increasing levels of physical activity. It will also address key barriers to access and social employment and other opportunities for those who do not have access to a private vehicle. In that context, I am determined to continue to enhance public transport links to our airports, but it is important we do so in a way that genuinely improves the opportunities available to those travelling to and from our airports. There are currently a number of public transport options for those travelling to and from Belfast International Airport, including to the centre of Belfast. These include the designated 300 bus service, which operates 50 times each day, 7 days a week, and with a frequency of 20 minutes at peak times. It is a reflection of the flexibility and quality of that service that last year it carried nearly 500,000 passengers between Belfast city centre and the airport. With a fast journey time of 30 minutes, high passenger numbers, it is not a wonder that Translink plan to invest in new double-decker vehicles for this route, adding passenger capacity. In promoting the use of public transport and enhancing access, there would appear to be obvious merits in introducing a rail link to the international airport. However, it is estimated that annual passenger numbers through to the international airport would have to be around 10 million to make this service economically viable.
Will the Minister give way?
I will indeed, yeah.
I appreciate the Minister giving way. He's just highlighted the issue of the success of the 300 Airbus, which of course doesn't just serve the airport, but also serves Templepatrick and Ballymartin, where a considerable number of passengers come from. In that context, when he's talking about the railway line, will he also talk about Ballinderry, Glenavy and Crumlin, and not just the airport?
I thank the member for his intervention. I think it has been discussed at length, actually, during the debate, that this isn't just simply a rail link to the airport. But when we're looking at this rail link, certainly these figures are very much part of any feasibility analysis and how we go forward. Last year, 4.4 million passengers used the Belfast International Airport, an increase of almost 10% on the previous year. Passenger numbers are projected to continue to grow in the forthcoming years and projected to exceed 10 million by approximately 2030. It is really only at this stage that we could realistically look at the potential to introduce a rail link to the airport. Extending a rail link to the international airport would most likely involve the reopening of the Antrim-Knockmore line and the construction of a spur and rail halt close to the airport terminal. The cost of this has previously been estimated at anywhere between £50 to £100 million. Even were passenger numbers at the airport to reach 10 million per year, the real benefits to passengers of introducing a rail link are likely to be limited. It is highly unlikely that rail could provide a more regular or cost-effective link that was not already provided by bus. Therefore, while I fully support the objective to enhance access to the international airport, the provision of a rail link must be a longer-term objective. In enhancing public transport access to the international airport, my immediate priority will be to continue to invest in and support high-quality, frequent and affordable bus connections which meet passenger needs. I can assure members that I remain committed to investment in our rail network. Indeed, the Executive has set aside funding for significant investment to complete Phase 2 on the Derry to Coleraine line, as well as planning to develop new transport hubs in Belfast City Centre and Derry at a cost of over £200 million. I will continue to make the case for investment in our rail network. My immediate priority for railway investment, however, is to maintain and improve passenger capacity on the existing network. This approach has delivered significant increases in passenger numbers on rail services in the recent past. As passenger numbers at the international airport approach 10 million, I would wish to explore the opportunities to establish a rail link, but to do so well in advance is unlikely to offer real benefits to passengers or indeed the airport. Turning now to some of the specific points raised by members, mention has been made of the possibility of establishing a rail freight hub at the international airport. It is thought that this would encourage the use of rail freight. No freight has been carried on local railways since 2003. Although there are benefits to moving freight off-road and onto rail, these benefits can only be realised where it provides a cost-effective alternative to road. As a relatively small landmass with easy access to ports, road is generally more competitive in terms of both speed and flexibility. Some members have raised the issue of the cost of maintaining the Knockmore to Antrim section of track. Since 2010, TransLink has spent around £1.5 million on keeping this section in its current condition. The benefit of this is that it enables TransLink to use the track for staff training, as well as reducing the cost of any future reinstatement of services, should the circumstances permit. The existing rail infrastructure passes close to George Best City Airport and the City of Derry Airport. Linking these airports directly by rail may not necessarily be the best way to serve the gateways by public transport. TransLink provide frequent and popular bus services to both of these airports. My department's priorities are to maintain and improve passenger capacity and remove bottlenecks on the existing rail network. This does not preclude new halts where passenger demand justifies it and additional finance is attainable. Mr. Speaker, or Prívlas Concolia, I have asked my officials to take note of the Hansard report for this debate, and if I have not addressed any of the points that have been raised here today by members, I will indeed correspond with them in response. In conclusion, I welcome this motion. I fully support the objective to enhance access to the international airport. However, my immediate priority will be to continue to invest in and support high-quality, frequent and affordable bus connections which meet passenger needs. The provision of a rail link must be a longer-term objective, and one which we will explore as annual passenger numbers at the airport approach 10 million. Coramila Mogat.
Trevor Clark, and Trevor Clark will have 10 minutes to wind.
Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I start with saying, Minister, I welcomed your comments at the start of your brief, and I obviously I'm pleased with most of the comments by most of the members in the Chamber today, indeed your own constituency, or my constituency colleague and one of your own colleagues, in terms of the greater need for that connectivity. However, I am slightly despaired by your closing comments, because even the interjection by our other colleague in South Antrim, where he did refer to the other villages, all of us as representatives of South Antrim are very familiar that this motion was geared directly at the airport, but we could see the benefit to the other villages, Glenavy, Stonyford, Crumlin, Lagan Valley, everywhere else and beyond. So, I mean, but most of your commentary has been based around the business case of the 10 million passengers. And dare I say, and I'm usually quite rude with some officials, the officials have got it wrong previously in DRD, as you know. There was a report done, as I did in an interjection today, remind the Speaker at that particular time, the officials brought in the services to do an estimate of the numbers for those using the line between Coleraine and Londonderry. And whenever that was realised, it was 225% out in terms of their projection. So just by desktop exercises don't merely demonstrate the use of what the public transport may yield in the future. So it's with that tone, Minister, that I'm asking you again to look and to charge your officials to look at this with fresh eyes, because There is communities in Crumlin, Glenavy, Stonyford and others who are locked into a corner, and the 300 service doesn't serve them whatsoever. The 300 service is a good service, but it's only connecting the airport to Belfast, and it's not connecting the hinterland around that particular area. Or indeed, if it does, they have a considerable distance to travel to actually join that service. So I suggest if they were to use the 300 service, it probably would be easy for them to drive straight on to Belfast rather than try and catch the 300 bus. Indeed, some of us had made representation to your department recently to try and let that others use the 300 service, but TransLink wouldn't let other passengers in that area provide a halt at the airport area in relation to Cricketstone, which would have allowed the people in that hinterland again ride up as far as Nuts Corner to come down to get onto the 300 service. And it's because the airport wanted an express service from there, indeed, but it stops in Templepatrick. Much has been said today, Minister, about the benefits of this line. I mean, and as you have said in your remarks about the $1.5 million that's been spent, and I suppose that's not a huge amount of money from 2010. However, I think there'd be much more benefit if we could see that line opened again for the use of the people in that hinterland and indeed the airport. I mean, my colleague who opened in the debate talked about build it and they will come. I mean, I do believe if we do build it, they will come, and I think the testament for that is if we look at the example that was used in the coal range in Londonderry. They did build the line. They had a very substandard service. Indeed, I was not that train myself, and I felt I would never get on it again because it felt unsafe on it. But now that they've built that railway line, their estimates were blown completely out of the water, and as I've already said, 225% over what they projected. I believe what my colleague has presented and others have presented today is it is a case of build it and they will come. I mean, there's nothing can take in, and I don't know how they could do a piece of work around the growth that's been in Crumlin and Glenavy. I mean, I would say, dare say, Crumlin and Glenavy have almost doubled in size in terms of people, and those people are commuting. I think the figure, and I'm sure you'll have it yourself, Minister, I think the estimate there's something like 1,100 pupils leave Crumlin on a daily basis to leave Crumlin to go to other towns in terms of our education. So again, this railway line from Crumlin to connect towards the airport would alleviate some of the problems relating to the buses. So this is not only about the airport, this is about the connectivity between the villages, but I think the airport in itself, and I mean, Steve Aiken did give us 4 minutes speech about how successful the airport has been, and I think that is a good thing. You've said in even in your own remarks about the growth within the airport, and I think that's something we should all welcome. But I mean, in its own right, it's capturing about 5.5 million of your 10 million passenger trigger. If you actually add that to the numbers of all the other people outside of that area who could use that, I think you could easily surpass the 10 million figure in relation to that. So, Minister, just maybe to round off in terms of what some of the members have said today, Paul, my colleague for South Antrim, did open the debate, and he said about he did even suggest about the opportunity in terms of the enterprise zone and how all these things fit together in the bigger picture. I mean, I listened to the debate on the radio the other day where there was one of our, I think it was a new, on the newsletter, where they talked about there was an argument they've had about one regional airport in Northern Ireland and is there actually a need for the other two airports? And I think that's something that will come forward in the future. I know Steve has brought forward bad news today in relation to the City of Derry Airport. Maybe that's news that we're going to hear on a more regular basis, because I think Belfast International has got the right location. It's central in Northern Ireland, and I think we need, as an executive, to do more to invest, to assist it, and then indeed the benefits that we'll get from the wider area. Following on from Paul, then, we had Jenny Palmer, who, whilst she welcomed the motion, I was somewhat confused, because then she went on to criticise our fact that we are actually coming forward with an ambitious plan. And others welcomed the ambition in terms of what we were suggesting, and indeed others were adding to that ambition. So at the same time, we did hear about their 10-point plan yesterday, which has been mentioned a few times today, even in question time, about the three times the investment in the infrastructure, but no suggestion where that money comes from. So I thought it was a bit rich for the criticism in relation to ours, but if they'd taken time to read the motion, we're wanting to work with you, Minister, in relation and your department to try and bring this forward. And I think the only way we're going to deliver most things in Northern Ireland is by a partnership approach and everyone actually joining together. Fra went on to talk about the use of the trains and how much it's cleaner and how it's better for the environment. Well, I suppose I'll take that one because he's on our side in relation to that. And I suppose the argument in terms of the environment is a different one entirely. But there is an opportunity to create jobs. And Fran did talk about the creation of jobs if we could get more people transferred into buses, or off the roads and into our trains and get them to commute a much easier form of transport and a much more reliable. I mean, I come in from the M2, there's some mornings you don't know what to expect when you come to Sandy Knowles, whether it's still going to be congested or otherwise. Whereas we have, and I think your department has done a lot in terms of reliability of TransLink, whether it be between buses or trains. So I think this is another reason why this actually would work. And then we had support from the west of the province in terms of support and connectivity from Daniel McCrossan and the opportunities for business and how it would stimulate economic growth. So again, we're hearing the positivity of some parties, even though, I mean, they both joined together in opposition, but they're both not in the exact same message. But that's for themselves to sort out. The rest of us were on message in relation to that today. Then we heard from Kelly Armstrong, who I know has worn a different hat in a previous life in terms of community transport. So she'll understand exactly the difficulties that isolated communities have, such as Glenavies and Crumlins, who are sitting there out in the aids with no connectivity. So I welcome the comments from Kelly and the time I worked with her in her previous life in terms of the importance of connecting our rural communities and getting them into hubs. And I welcome the fact that, again, Kelly joined with the rest of us in welcoming that idea for you to work with you, Minister, on a way forward to try and map the way forward that we can get this ambitious project somewhere in the future, that we can see some sense of reality in relation to the start of this particular project. Then we heard from Edwin Putz in relation to he was doing a bit of reminiscing between himself and my colleague from South Honour, Mr. Ford, in terms of the work that they've both been doing in this. And I mean, I don't want to take away from that. I think the more we shout about this, the more the opportunity of this becoming a reality. And again, most of what they were talking about was the linkages of the other communities outside of the greater airport area. Then your own my consistency colleague and your own colleague, Declan Kearney, I have to say I was very heartened by what Declan had to say again about those isolated communities and what they need. And even in Declan's contribution, he talks about the enterprise zone in the future. So again, we see we're all coming at this in the same direction, that we see the real benefits that this can deliver for not only for Southampton, but it's actually for Northern Ireland. We can see this as a gateway, and we can see an airport that actually connects us better with Belfast than what we currently have. And that's not taken away from the growth that the airport have had, and that's because obviously they've had additional flights. But I think in the long term, if we had a better connection between the two locations, then I think we can actually assist on that growth. We heard from Alex Easton about the need for the best possible infrastructure, and I don't think anyone could argue against that. Steve, I think, was a wee bit more sceptical of Paul's view about build it than they will come. But then I think he came onto our page in relation, and now he's nearly turned from where he started at. He's now championing the cause. So I'm glad you've had that change of heart, Steve, and actually joined this band or joined this train. We'll maybe need an extra carriage in this train to get you to come along. But your later comments were welcome, and you're welcome with that view. Gordon Lyons talked about the.
I'd ask the member to bring his remarks to a close.
I will. Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. I think the essence of what I want to say here, Minister, take as much consideration as you can in relation to this, but we want to see you charge your officials with coming with it, build it so as it will come.
The member's time is up. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it.